Hi everyone and welcome to our Jigsaw webinar series for teachers in collaboration with ESCE, the Education Support Centre of Ireland. I want to welcome you all here today. My name is Erica and I am a clinician in Jigsaw and I'm here on the panel by my colleague Michelle Lowry, who is also a Jigsaw clinician. We're joined by our two other panel members, Lucia Ryan, who is principal in Hartstown Community School Clonsilla, and Fiona Temple, who is principal in Mulroy College, Milfort in Donegal. So I want to thank you all for joining us, and a particular thank you to our two principals for joining us. We really value your expertise on this particular subject. So for today's webinar, we're going to discuss the topic of school connectedness. So just to run through the format of the webinar, Michelle and I will begin by providing a context for the discussion. So we'll discuss what we mean by school connectedness and why in Jigsaw are we interested in the topic of school connectedness, the factors that influence it. And importantly, we'll discuss how in these current times, while we're all working remotely, how can schools continue to remain connected. We'll open up then with a panel discussion. We'll invite Fiona and Lucia to share some of their views, perspectives and experiences. And then we'll open up for a live question and answer. So please feel free to submit any questions that you might have and we'll answer these at the end. And the questions will remain anonymous. So it's only Michelle and I who will see the names and they won't be read out. So please feel free to submit any questions. We'll read them at the end, but you're free to submit them from the beginning. So firstly, the school community. Firstly, we just want to draw attention to the various connections that exist within the school community. So the school community encompasses a very wide variety of individuals, groups, and stakeholders. So we have the students, the teachers, the administrators, all staff members who work in the school and on the grounds. So in addition to the students, we have their parents and families, local residents, community members, and a number of organisations that have a stake in the school's success, so such as board members, local businesses and parents associations. So there are a lot of individuals who might not necessarily be in the school building physically on a daily basis, but still make up that school community. And an ecological view of school connectedness takes into account the quality of the connections among these multiple groups in the school community and recognises the cohesiveness among these different groups. So school connectedness is made up of many of these connections and it's the interplay of all of these connections that can have a significant impact on students' feelings of connectedness to their school. So I'm going to move on to what is school connectedness, and I'll hand you over to Michelle.
Yeah, so I guess when you guys maybe signed up for this webinar and we think about the concept of school connectedness, I suppose there's many ideas and terminologies that maybe come to mind when we think about it. And I suppose often we think of concepts such as engagement, you know, bonding, attachment, belonging being a very strong one, and things like relationships and culture and ethos, and active engagement or involvement, and particularly caring. I suppose there's lots of different terms that we can use when we think about school connectedness, and there's certainly lots of different ways that we can define it as well. So I suppose in the definition of school connectedness in our next slide, I suppose we've chosen here in Jigsaw just to talk about school connectedness being the extent to which a young person feels like they belong at school and feels cared for by the school community. And really, I guess this involves like an intricate web of relationships, values, cultures and environments experienced not only just by that young person, but by everybody within that school community as well. So it really is this web that comes together to support this idea of school connection. And it's not just like it's a experience by the young person, but everybody within the school community that is involved in that.
Significance of school connectedness. So why here in Jigsaw are we interested in this concept? I suppose on exploring the research concerning school connectedness, we could see that school connectedness, it has been found to positively impact educational outcomes and developmental competencies. So there is increasing consensus that educational attainment and well-being are interconnected, and that a positive environment at school promotes both educational and well-being outcomes. It's been seen as a potential predictor for risk-taking behaviour. So students with low levels of school connectedness have been predicted to be more at risk of risk-taking behaviour, so such as alcohol and substance use, violence-related behaviours, self-harm and other risk-taking behaviours. And also it's been seen as a protective factor in youth mental health. So school connectedness, it's been found to be associated with a number of positive outcomes in relation to young people's mental health and well-being. So such as increased self-esteem, improved coping skills, social skills, lower emotional distress. What's evident from the research that there is a positive correlation between young people feeling connected to their school and their mental health and well-being. So that leads us on to our next slide. So the My World survey to the National Study of Youth Mental Health in Ireland. So this study was carried out by Jigsaw in collaboration with UCD School of Psychology. The original My World survey was carried out in 2000. More recently in 2019, the My World survey 2 was published. So this study draws on various risk and protective factors from multiple environments in which young people interact. So in relation to the school environment, school connectedness was identified as a protective factor for youth mental health, so reinforcing what was found in previous research. In relation to other findings, there was an associated link with school connectedness and school non-attendance. So those with higher school connectedness were less likely to be absent from school. So perhaps not terribly surprising to some people. And indeed, research in the past had shown correlations between non-attendance and other factors such as school engagement, relationships with peers and teachers, school climate and culture. So all elements quite largely related to school connectedness. In addition, first year students were found to have higher school connectedness than third, fifth and sixth year students. And in general, the junior cert cycle students were found to have higher school and peer connectedness than the senior cycle students. So I suppose we don't have exact reasons as to why exactly this is, but we could kind of hypothesize that, you know, developmental factors that might have been influencing this finding. So I suppose as young people get older, there's often more pressures, more responsibilities. Exam pressure with leaving cert is a big one. We know that exam pressure is a top stressor for young people. So it would be interesting to look into this a little bit more as to why the younger years are feeling a little bit more connected to school and to their peers. Females were reported to have higher school connectedness than their male peers. So again, we won't have exact reasons as to why, but across the board, research has shown that in general, females have been found to be more likely to seek help and seek social support, and sometimes more likely to talk about their problems. Different research studies have found this. The perceived ranking in the class was associated with reported levels of school connectedness. So students who ranked themselves as bottom of the class, perceived themselves to be bottom of the class as opposed to middle or top, were more likely to have lower levels of school connectedness than those that ranked themselves at the top of the class or the middle of the class, which is interesting. And in addition, high levels of school connectedness were associated with the presence of one good adult. So the term one good adult, you might be aware, originated from the original My World survey and refers to an adult that young people can turn to if they're in need of support. So the students with higher levels of school connectedness were more likely to have a one good adult in their lives. Now, factors that influence school connectedness. And over to you there, Michelle. I'm not sure if you can hear me.
I was mute. Apologies.
Oh, sorry.
So I guess, you know, with Erica, we've seen just how significant school connectedness is, and I suppose in Jigsaw we're particularly concerned with connectedness being, I suppose, a significant protective factor in the area of youth mental health. I suppose what we look at here is the number of factors that can influence school connectedness. And I suppose when we look at these as well, we can consider that, you know, in this current situation of COVID-19, there is a certain amount of rethinking, I suppose, required of schools in order to maintain school connectedness. I suppose we look at factors like, you know, positive school climate, and this might refer to to things such as the physical environment, so the building, the accessibility of that building, the physical space and how it's laid out. It might also refer to things like the social environment, how inclusive that school may be, as well as the ethos, the culture of that school. I heard a teacher refer to entering a school and you know by a school by its feeling that you get when you walk in the door. And I suppose that's something that describes that feeling that each school kind of represents. That speaks to the culture, to the ethos of each school community. Other factors then, I suppose, that can influence school connectedness refers to maybe the learning environment. And we know that this has changed a lot now, but I suppose in the traditional sense, this would refer to maybe the teaching methods and the classroom management methods that a teacher may employ. I suppose, you know, fostering opportunities for success and recognising achievement for students within that classroom environment as well can really go a long way in supporting that student's sense of connection to the school. And the factors such as engagement and participation refers to providing opportunities for all members of the school community really to feel heard, to have their say, to maybe be involved in decision making, decisions that, you know, are likely going to affect them. But having some opportunities to be involved in that decision making process really refers to this idea of engagement and participation. And then the last factor then that can really, and I suppose probably one of the most important factors that we've learned that has a big impact on school connectedness is this factor around relationships. And relationships being ones that are defined by care, by trust, by support, and that are supported really by open communication. And these relationships may exist between students and their teachers, may exist between students themselves, or indeed other members within the school community as well. So I guess, you know, in the current situation, we want to think about, well, how can schools maybe respond to some of the challenges that they're faced at the moment, and how can they actually maintain some school connectedness? So I suppose this first factor around maintaining caring student and teacher relationships, again, we must acknowledge that the capacity to maintain this is dependent on a number of factors. But I guess, you know, what's important is to think about the interactions that are happening can be supported with care and communicated with care by acknowledging maybe from the teacher's perspective to the student that, you know, the student is not only a student, but is a young person themselves as well. And that common humanity piece around acknowledging that all of us, teachers, students, as humans, we're experiencing the current situation of COVID-19 as one that is jointly very stressful. And let's normalize that. Let's validate that in that experience. So I suppose in those interactions, checking in, yes, on the academic activities and tasks at hand, but also on how that young person maybe is getting on, how they're coping, how they're responding at the moment, what's going on for them right now. I guess other things we might want to think about is how students are connecting with one another and how schools can maybe consider opportunities for students to connect with one another. So there might be, for example, small project groups that could break off, for example, to work on things together. I know parents would have expressed concerns maybe about their young people at home not having many opportunities to connect with peers at school that they would have in the classroom environment. So maybe opportunities such as project work can provide this opportunity for students. You know, there might be pre-existing structures, for example, like committees, like steering groups, like student councils, that maybe can still operate to some capacity in the virtual world as well and can provide some opportunities for connecting with one another. I guess it goes without saying, but communication really is key. And I guess when we think about communication, we need to think about, I suppose, our channels of communication. So how are the school maybe communicating to the other members of the school community, whether that may be by virtual means, phone calls, or I heard someone referring to the snail mail and going back to traditional methods of communication where even newsletters are produced. And I suppose maybe also considering opportunities for this communication to maybe be a two-way process, so to be able to maybe receive feedback from parents, from young people, from both colleagues and teaching staff about how they're doing at the moment, what's working well for them. So communication doesn't have to be just a one-way stream, it can be a two-way process also. And I suppose we might not always maybe receive responses. I know this has been some of the frustrations or concerns even expressed by schools that we might not receive responses from those in the school community. But I suppose the key really is acknowledging that the door is open. And I suppose people know that you are available and that communication is coming and is welcomed indeed from anybody, I suppose, at any time when it is, I suppose, required. I guess another factor that we want to think about is that students and families are maybe are signposted to the available support options that maybe do exist still within the school community, whether that be, for example, guidance counselor support services, or indeed maybe outside the school community that might be required for parents or for families or for young people themselves who might require some additional support at the moment. So maybe schools can maybe provide a support in terms of providing some signposting and some information to these individuals as well. And I suppose not forgetting that support options, not just for maybe parents and young people, but also for school staff and teachers. So ensuring that, I suppose, school staff are aware of support options available to them. And this, I suppose, in this current time might be practical support. I think teachers are becoming learners. Once again, someone referred to that before, in terms of navigating this online space at the moment, these virtual platforms, and a lot of new learning is happening at the moment. So it may be practical support, but it may also be social support or indeed emotional support as well that's required for school staff, and ensuring that the school can provide maybe platforms or indeed kind of signposting support for where school staff may be able to access that. And I guess the last point really is just acknowledging that, you know, for the entire school community, whether that be your parent, your teacher, your young person, well-being really is a shared priority among all of us. And I guess that's the message that we really wanted to ensure, I suppose, is received by all members of the school community as a way that we connect with one another, because this is a shared priority. Well-being is our priority right now. And I guess we have to adjust maybe some of our expectations, and we're all being adaptable and we're all being very flexible at the moment. And well-being is really of utmost importance in the context of all of that right now. So I guess we're going to expand on some of these in our panel discussion. So we're going to welcome some input from Fiona and from Lucia, who I suppose can provide the lived experience examples of how they're navigating the current space of COVID-19 at the moment.
Absolutely. Thanks for that, Michelle. To open it up, the panel discussion, I suppose I'm going to stop sharing my screen for the moment. Yeah, now I can see you again. I suppose from your experience, can you share some of the challenges that your school has experienced in this area of connectedness in recent times? So Fiona or Lucia?
Yeah. Can I go ahead? Hi everyone. I suppose some of the challenges that we've experienced is, I think on the last slide there, as Michelle had said, that communication is absolutely key. And I suppose we've watched the way we communicate evolve so quickly, kind of tests and trials and doing different things. And I suppose the first few weeks I found I was sending an awful lot of letters to parents and a lot of updates and bulletins, and I was missing an awful lot of that bit of chat and bit of banter with people. So we found that challenging at first, and I was kind of going, God, they're going to get sick of me sending letters. And I was sick of writing myself, to be honest, dear parent guardian. So we found that a bit of a challenge at first, making sure that the communication that we were using was that the tone and language and the personality of the person, whether it was myself or the senior management team or teachers, whatever message we were trying to get across, that our tone and personality was trying to come through it as well. So that was a bit of a challenge at first. We found it just got very tiring for us to be writing letters and that to be communicating that way, but also very tiring for the parents as well and for the students to be just getting notifications and updates like that. So we kind of moved from that to doing a weekly podcast, where our guidance counsellor does a weekly podcast, and she kind of delivers a lot of the updates and the information to students and parents. And it's, you know, personality can come through, and you can smile, you can give a wink, you can give a laugh, and have that little bit of a banter through that with students and with parents as well. It's you know, it's addressed to both. So that's kind of how we tackled that in the first couple of weeks. We just found there's in a more positive way of communicating, as opposed to just delivering information, trying to actually use the skills we have as teachers to communicate in the most positive way possible and try and make some bit of a connection there from person to person. I know, and as you've mentioned already, that you don't get a response back because it's a one-way kind of thing until maybe a day or two later. But we did find there were definitely more people who were able to view it and more people enjoyed viewing it as well. So that was kind of one of our challenges at first.
Yeah, we were very similar to what you're saying, Lucia, that initially it was about even thinking about how are we going to communicate, because the school is so diverse and there are so many stakeholders that you communicate with every day. Normally the different levels of communication that you have are quite complex, so we had to really split that down and figure out ourselves how are we going to do this in a meaningful way. And like Lucia said, when you just look at the written word, sometimes you're just not sure how that's going to be interpreted either, and you're so used to that face-to-face contact all the time. And then we were also challenged by the level of information that we needed to disseminate amongst staff and students and parents that you felt, gosh, I can't send another text, I can't send another notice out, because it was just, I mean, we were becoming overwhelmed by the level of information we were getting, but yet we had to, as we had a sense of responsibility, obviously, to keep everybody updated with that. And then with all of that communication, people can become very overwhelmed very, very quickly. And there needed to be a sense of the school needed to have control and needed to think about, well, how are we doing things? So we simply looked at, well, what's going to work best for us and what's going to work best for our students, for our staff? And we looked at, well, how is teaching and learning happening? And we're a Google school, so we use Google Chrome and all students are in Google Classroom. And thankfully that was all straightforward enough and we were all set up for that. I was sending weekly letters out to students, but we were missing the face-to-face piece. So we set up a phone service so that parents could ring in and speak to either myself or the deputy. We allocated a certain time frame in the day so that we could have that communication piece. And we're online now and do daily assemblies with each year group. So it's a different group every day. And that has made all the difference. The assemblies for the students have just made all the difference. So even if we have students that are maybe struggling with the online platform of learning, they're usually the first to sign up to the assembly because they're the ones that need that connected piece. Whereas the student who's on the Google Classroom every day and fully engaged is probably getting a good connected piece there.
Things frozen.
You just have a little bit of connection issue there. But I guess what I'm hearing from that, just until Fiona comes back, I suppose, is it seems like we're missing the relationship piece quite a lot, isn't it? And like what we talk about with communication, teaching is so much more, from a teacher's perspective, it's so much more than the academic task or the education task. It is those, I suppose, moments that you have with students, those interactions, those non-verbals, those how you let a student know that you've seen them or you've heard them or you've noticed them and that you care about them, and that's checking in. And that, like you say, that might be the wink or the nod in the corridor or the tap on the shoulder or whatever it might be. I know as a clinician, I'm certainly missing that connection piece as well. I think I relate to that somewhat. What's interesting to hear was how we're responding to that and how schools are responding to that by individualizing, maybe, I suppose, how you're communicating at the moment. So I suppose thinking about the channels through which you're communicating and individualizing that seems to be very important, which is great. I suppose from yourself, you see, it was, can you expand on that a little bit in terms of kind of with some of that individualization? So you mentioned podcasts was one kind of mechanism that your school has kind of used. Has that worked for all, or?
Yeah, it's I suppose the first kind of thing that we went to was we moved from kind of letters and stuff to a newsletter then, whereas at least you could add a bit more color or personal message, or you could be a bit more informal as opposed to this letter. So we moved from the newsletter then onto a podcast, where we thought, like, our guidance counselor who checks in with all of our students, and very popular in the school and has a really good reputation with all the students, or good relationship, I mean, with all the students. And we thought that, for them listening to her, it would be much more personal, as opposed to it all kind of coming from me as well, so as a principal. But so it kind of evolved like that. And I think, as Fiona had mentioned there with the relationships, and I think teachers are missing that so much as well. I know our students are as well, but our teachers are missing that so much as well. The chat at the end of a class, or the asking how someone's getting on in their match or whatever they're doing, whether it's a musical or the match, that little bit of a relationship. It's hard to let that go as well, to kind of making sure that you're online learning. It's not just the delivery of information, that you're just checking in as well, and how are you getting on, and how's mum and dad, how's the dog, how's your granny, the neighbour, are you doing okay, what are you doing to keep sane, kind of thing. And just being normal, I suppose, about it, being very normal about it, and sharing a little bit of yourself as well, going, god, yeah, we're busy here and we're up the walls. And so I think, and that's been going quite well, and I think people have relaxed into that much more after the first couple of weeks. Because I know we're all a bit nervous online first, but then you do kind of relax into it and go, do you know what, it's still communication and may not be face to face, but I can still have a laugh and I can still tell a joke and I can still get on with my teaching as well, you know. So
definitely. And we'd love to be there for a moment, but I just want to bring her back.
Don't know what happens.
we're going to roll with this.
We're getting used to that. That's okay.
But I guess, Fiona, you've been asked here, what platform do you use actually for hosting your assemblies? I think one of the participants was keen to hear that.
Yeah, we just use Google Hangout. So our assemblies, our largest assembly, I think we've had up to about 100 students in one year group. So as the students come in, we just set it up like a normal Hangout. And as the students come in, we just ask everyone to mute their mic. And because if everybody has their microphone on, it won't work. So the principal and the deputy, myself and then my deputy principal would always have our microphones on live. And we'd always give students the option of they don't have to have their camera on if they don't want to. And then they can use the comment, the chat section along the side if they want to make comment or ask questions as we're going along then. So, and it works well, and we have it midday, like, you know, we were talking earlier about expectations, about being realistic. Normally our assemblies would be first thing in the morning, they'd be at 10 to 9 if we were in school, but we decided not to opt for that. And we talked to our students about that. Just before Easter, we surveyed the students on what was working for them and what wasn't. And that was the piece, just like Lucia said, they just missed just those comments, just that crack and those interactions that they were having with teachers naturally in the corridors. And they needed, they really wanted to hear people's voice and they wanted to see people as much as possible. So that's where the assemblies then came from, and it's working really well. We use that for our staff meetings, for all of our meetings, we meet student leadership teams, we do board of management, student support, AP1 meetings, all of that, and it all works well through Google Hangouts.
Okay. Brilliant. Yeah, and it's great getting that feedback from the students. I suppose even just connectedness in general, just getting their view on what's working for them is so valuable. The question about, you know, what challenges are you finding in the current times? It's kind of naturally gone to kind of how you've been responding to those challenges, and I suppose kind of discussed kind of the different solutions to those challenges, and it seems to be a lot around communication and those relationships.
I think everything has been about communication for us, and you know, maybe a piece about resource and, you know, making sure that everyone had IT and that type of thing as well. But we also had to make sure when we were setting up platforms that everybody would have access to that, because in Milford, quite a lot of our families are quite rural, and they might have difficulties with broadband and internet connections. So we really had to rethink our teaching on that as well, to make sure that there wasn't a need for our students to be on their device all of the time. So teachers then had to start rethinking about maybe the pieces of work that they were assigning and making sure that students were actually getting away from the device while they were doing that. So we had a bit of work to do on that as well. I suppose the suddenness of the closure left you out of the school, and maybe a few days later realizing, oh, we should have done this, we should have done that. And there may not have been, there were some students who actually just weren't in the school that day either. So they weren't able to access books out of lockers and things like that. So it was coming up with creative ways of making sure that they could still access resources. And I think the expectation piece is really important too, because there's so much happening for people at the minute. There's so much happening in all households, and none of us know what that's like for anyone else. And we have students who have not maybe engaged in a way that we would have wanted them to. So we decided that we would make phone calls and we would just connect in with those families. And it was never going to be a call asking, you know, why are you not on Google Classroom, or why is the homework not done? It was always just a call. I'm just ringing. How are you getting on? And we've made hundreds of calls at this stage, and everyone has been welcomed. Every phone call has been, oh, it's so good to hear, whether it's for me or the year ahead or whoever, just to know that somebody's out there just thinking of you and just wondering how you're all doing. And then eventually the call, you know, the conversation will go to education and what's needed, and maybe there's more commitment needed, or maybe there's issues that we can resolve. But those actually having, you know, that the voice-to-voice communication, even over a telephone, has made a huge difference. And the same for staff, just, you know, sometimes if I get emails, and I know other staff do it, then rather than emailing back, I'll just, oh, here, I'm just going to pick up the phone and talk to them. It's just so much easier, because you do get a bit overwhelmed yourself with all of this digital age. And it's just, it's easier to connect in when you can just hear someone's voice, you know.
Definitely. It certainly seems that schools are adapting a lot to really, I suppose, try and reach out to students and to foster connectedness, I suppose, among students, and ensure, I suppose, channels of communication are left open. And I'm hearing that the staff are doing quite a lot, I suppose, just on that, in terms of staff. How are we supporting maybe staff at the moment to connect with one another as a group, as colleagues? I suppose in our self-care webinar, we would have talked a lot about the importance of the support that staff feel from one another in the teaching context, I suppose. So how maybe are your schools responding to that piece and supporting staff?
Well, I think from the start, we were kind of, when I look back at the start, it was a huge jump. We all peaked and everybody was rushing and it was very busy, and was trying to kind of keep things steady. We kind of came into a routine and into a bit of a flow, and people had all their stuff set up, whatever they needed. But I think I was very conscious with people to say, you know, don't get too stressed over things, and make sure you're looking after yourself, making sure that you're, you know, whatever your own personal circumstances are at home, as you'd mentioned earlier there, that nobody knows what's going on in anybody's house. People are at home minding children, or they're minding parents, or they're minding siblings, they're struggling on their own. There's a lot of different things going on in people's lives. So I think we were very conscious to say, don't be too hard on yourself. If somebody's not engaging with your, or, you know, if you're concerned about this person or that person not engaging, that there's only so much control you have. I think, you know, as teachers, we're so used to having that control in the classroom of, I know how to carry this student along. I know what they need to hear to get involved. And I know the type of encouragement that they need, whether it's the come on and get going, or the, you know, how are you doing? They just know them so much better. So, and it's very difficult to not be able to do that then, and people can be very hard on themselves. So I think we've just been kind of reiterating the message of, don't be comparing yourself to others either, because I know that, like, the you know, some people have fantastic Wi-Fi access and fantastic skills when using IT and stuff and creating lessons. Other people don't have the same Wi-Fi access. You know, many of our teachers are in rural areas, and trying to say, well, don't compare yourself to each other, everyone's doing the best that they can, and to don't be too stressed about it, just to mind yourself and take care of yourself, and everyone's doing the best they can, and that we understand that, and we're getting that. And we've been chatting on the phone a lot to our teachers, checking in every now and again with everybody, to make sure people are, and it's just a chat, and it's just a bit of banter, and just how are you getting on, and how's the family, and so just making sure that they're heard as well, and that we're listening to whatever struggles that are coming up from week to week, and that we're trying to address that then in the best way that we can.
We would have talked, I suppose, quite a bit in previous webinars about self-care, about the importance of, you know, looking after yourself, and there really is only so much that one individual can do.
Yeah.
It kind of leads me to actually a question that came in from a participant here, so I might put it towards you. Is it difficult to attend to the present and plan ahead for the new academic year and still look after yourself? So I'm kind of leading on.
Sorry, go on ahead, Lucia, go on ahead.
Sorry, if you want to. I think with kind of maybe such lack of clarity on very specific things, like when's the date to come back, we're so used to a timetable and a start date and an end date, and we're very used to that. So letting go of that and kind of coming up with plan A, plan B, plan C, different types of contingency plans, that's what we're looking at the moment, to say if we're back in September and how will that look, Will it be a stepped approach? Will it be one full-on approach? Will it be half and half? And we don't know anything like that yet. So instead of maybe putting too much work or focus into what might happen, we're just focusing on the present and the next couple of weeks and trying to look after ourselves and look after our students, particularly our sixth years, over the next couple of weeks, and having planning in the background all right, but not, I suppose, spending too much time on one type of plan and then for it to be kind of given different advice then. So it's and in fairness to the government as well, they can't foresee too far into the future as well, so they're going week by week as well. But once we get more clarity from them, we can put proper things in place then. But at the moment, I think we only focus on what we can actually control at the moment, and not to put too much energy or worry or anxiety into what's going to happen in September, October. We will know more coming later. It's handy to have a backup plan there, but I think it's trying to focus on the present and making sure that we're keeping on a steady, even flow for the next while.
Yeah, we'd be very similar like that as well. I think, you know, it'd be lovely to know exactly what is happening and to go full steam ahead with a plan, but we just don't have that luxury. And I think it's really important, I suppose, in schools that we communicate that to everyone, because as teachers, we naturally need plans. We work off plans. We aren't good without them, truth be told, but this is where we're at the minute, and if we focus on that can bring a bit of negative energy, it can bring a lot of anxiety. That's not us looking after ourselves. So we're very focused on the plan that we do have and on the things that we do know. We're planning for next year in the capacity that we can, where you're looking at your allocation. There's a certain piece of work we're doing on accommodation that we would have been doing irrespective of coronavirus or not. So those pieces continue. And we are in the background, obviously sitting, thinking, right, how is it going to work and what's it going to look like? But you only go so far with that, because you know guidance will come, decisions will be made. You know, and I was saying to a group of students today at assembly that there can be great comfort as well in knowing that that is someone else's decision, that I can just park that, because that's not up to me to figure that out. And I would say that to students, you know, you concentrate on what you know. When the plan changes, we absolutely need to be flexible, and we've been thrown into this world now of embracing change and embracing flexibility, whether we like it or not. But I suppose schools have had huge change over the last, I would say over the last decade, and in particular over the last 5 years, the level of change that we have been dealing with has been extraordinary. This is a pace at which we're not used to, and this level of uncertainty we're not used to, but the future is still very positive, and education will continue, schools will continue, and our students will still progress on. And it's really important that they hear all of those things as well, and we send those messages out. But it can become difficult. So we're planning as best we can, I suppose.
Brilliant. And I suppose that's all we can do, isn't it? And like you say, I think we'd be pulling our hair out if we looked at all the things that we can't control right now.
Yeah.
Like, that's a really positive message. And like I say, leading with that message to students as well, is we're focusing on the things that we can't control right now, because that's all we can do. And we're no one's going to be left on their own in this process. We're in this journey together, as scary and unstable and uncertain as it feels. So we're literally in this together as a school community, I suppose, and we're going to respond as and when we get more direction, but we're going to work what we have right now. I'm just want to get to a few more questions here. Have either of the schools been able to assist any students who don't have internet or a device? So I guess just how maybe you've responded to some of those.
So we've had a number of particularly sixth year students that might not have had a device or not a suitable device. And we noticed that this became a problem really from, I think it was the second level of restrictions that came in. We found that there were just more people at home. So when schools closed, students might have had access to devices, and then 2 weeks later they didn't. So we have been able to facilitate where we have been giving out Chromebooks to some of our sixth year students that have needed it. We haven't had capacity to go beyond that. Internet is a problem, and we know that some families are having connection issues. So where that has happened, we have simply looked at printing out work and posting it out to students, particularly in the final assessment pieces now that are needed at the end of the year, and try and then, particularly for those students, making sure that when work is assigned, that it's not online based, that students can maybe do work, take a photograph of it and email it, so they don't need the big connection piece then for the Google Classroom. So that's how we're kind of getting around a bit of that.
Yeah, and what about yourself?
There really is so much for schools to think about now, all those as well as keeping students feeling connected, keeping the other, it really is so complex.
Yeah.
It is, yeah, because the range of students, we've quite a large school, and we'd have, I suppose, students that have been engaging extremely well, and we have our small cohort that haven't been engaging for various different reasons, and some of them that wouldn't be great at engagement during normal school hours anyway, but then others that would be maybe in emergency accommodation, and families that might have a lot of different challenges going on at home, where either there's one laptop between the whole lot, or they're all using their phones, or they might have Wi-Fi or a data limit or anything like that. So we did something similar to what Fiona is saying there. We're kind of focusing on our 6 years. We'd have about 226 years. So we surveyed our 6 years and tried to kind of figure out, well, who's in most need of devices. And then we've been delivering them bit by bit over the last day or two, but it took a while to kind of do that, which was unfortunate. It took a while to try and get all the logistics of that together, so it's only really happening now. It would have been great to be able to do all that maybe earlier on, but we just weren't able to. So I suppose when we were looking at our teaching and learning for online, that people were conscious of the times that they were delivering information, so that they weren't, I don't know, expecting a student to respond straight away, or that they were giving people enough time and it was kind of project based, as opposed to online and you have homework for tomorrow kind of thing. And making sure that some of the work isn't just specifically online work, that if they'd very low data or anything like that, all they had to do was take a picture. And we also kind of realized we had to send a lot of information on how to students on how to actually learn in that way. I think a lot of them were sending in kind of pictures that maybe weren't as clear. So, you know, teaching them how to use Microsoft Lens to upload a proper picture. And so they were doing a lot of work on their copybooks and then posting it on in that kind of way. So yeah, being very conscious of people's individual situations at home, but definitely it's been changing every single week. Every week there's a different update on, oh great, we can actually do this now, or we figured out how to do that. So it's, I suppose the timing of the year is difficult because we're coming towards the end of it now, and you know, all the things that we've figured out now, it would have been lovely to have had it weeks ago, but that's the nature of a crisis. So you just adapt as best you can from week to week and figure out where the supports need to go.
Definitely. I guess just on that, just to invite, maybe we've over 50 participants who've joined us for this webinar today, and I know we're inviting Q&A, but we'll also invite maybe comments or suggestions. So I guess what we'll try and do maybe at the end of this webinar is to capture all of that, if people maybe have their own experiences that they'd like to share, or suggestion that they've had, or how they've troubleshooted certain situations. Maybe what we might try and do is to capture all of that and to maybe provide a platform of where we kind of exchange some of those ideas once we post this webinar as well, with some of that comes in. And what strikes me really to see you and Fiona both yourselves, I suppose, have mentioned that when you're maybe faced with a challenge or a situation particularly related to the student population, what strikes me is that the initiation of surveys and getting actually input from students themselves about what's going on seems to be the first step, which is amazing to hear, that it's not making an assumption that you know exactly what the situation is or what the issue is in the first place, but actually getting that feedback first about, let me make sense of what's going on and how we can best support you guys, and that we're not going to blanket approach it, we're going to acknowledge that maybe each individual maybe has different needs. So that seems to be a really, I suppose, a striking thing that stood out to me, I suppose, when you both were talking there as well.
Yeah, I think the student voice and the parent voice as well, it has been the strongest it's ever been in the last few weeks, which is brilliant. They keep saying to them, once I know something, we can act on it then in the best way possible. So I think, yeah, definitely the student voice and the parent voice as well has been very, very strong over the last few weeks. As I say, the parent has stepped into the classroom now as well with us. So they're practically colleagues now with us. So, you know, so it's important to get their views on it as well and how they're doing at home. And, you know.
Yeah, and it's brought them in a very different way. It's, as you say, Lucy, it's very interesting how that has changed dynamics at home as well for everyone, because, you know, parents are in the classroom in a different capacity than what they would have been beforehand. And it's been really interesting to get their voice on all of this as well. And I know at the beginning when we talked about the challenges, part of that for us is making clear pathways of communication as well to make sure that parents knew how and who to contact if they needed an answer. And if it's simply just saying to them, look, send an email into the school and then we can redirect that, or, you know, contact your homeschool liaison officer, or, you know, setting up those structures ourselves to make sure that we actually can, where possible, have that two-way communication happening. And we needed that as much as anyone else, because we needed to make sure that whatever we were setting up was actually meeting the needs. And we may not have been aware of things that were happening. So it was of huge benefit to us, because we, there was no point in us going to any, you know, setting up supports for people if it wasn't going to be valued, if it wasn't going to be worthwhile. And it's lovely to hear then from students and from parents that they are feeling supported in that way, by just knowing I can still pick up the phone, I can send an email, someone will get back to me. And that's the same as what it would have been before the 12th of March. The only difference now is you're just not making an appointment and coming in the door. You know, we're still having that level of contact and communication and welcoming that and embracing that, because we need it as much as much as students and parents do. And I've said to students and parents along the way that our staff need that. Our staff need that response and need to hear from students, this is working for me, this is great, I'm feeling supported, my learning is continuing, I'm managing all of this. And teachers get great affirmation from that. And it's really important that they hear that, and that they hear it from the student, not just myself or other members of the management team, that they're getting that clear message from students. And we have told students that they have a very significant role in that. They have a role here of supporting us as much as we do with them. And they have really welcomed that and stood up to that platform too, which is really nice and really good.
Yeah, that's really, really good to hear. It sounds like you're kind of hitting on all those factors that influence school connectedness. You know, it's, you know, getting that feedback from students, and even for, yeah, you're saying, for staff themselves to feel connected, yeah, that's so important. I just have a comment in here. Those two principals are just fabulous. Well done to them and the great work that they're doing. They're a breath of fresh air. So from one participant there. So yeah, no, I think it's really, really great to hear all that you are doing, and it sounds like you respond to the challenges so quickly.
Well, it's very trial and error for everybody as well. I suppose now that we're so far into it, we could say this. I mean, if you'd have contacted me in the first or second week, I just wouldn't even have been able to have a conversation with you. So, you know, it's been an incredible journey that we have all been through. But, you know, no more than any critical incident that happens at school step up. You know, we're here for each other, and every single thing that we do is about minding each other, whether it is facing a WSE that comes at us or something like this. And granted, nobody could have predicted this, and we're all going through so much in it, and we're all people and we're all human, and it's just about acknowledging that. And I think we need to be honest with each other in that. And I feel it's okay for me to say to staff that I'm struggling today or whatever it may be, and it gives them a platform to be able to return that when they are having a bad day. The other thing that we started doing that I just wanted to share when I knew we were coming in here that I felt was helpful, and our students have said that they find it helpful, we set a different task for each of our students' groups as we meet them in assembly. So for example, our second year students are writing letters to our incoming first years. Our sixth years are, they send motivational quotes to me every week, and then they go up on our Facebook page and we send them out to other students and staff. I'll forget them all now. Our fifth years are setting, they're just writing letters about what they have learned during this period, and it's about what they've learned about themselves as much as anything else, and they're really identifying their values through that, and we're sharing a lot of this information, and I feel that students are really starting to connect to each other a little bit more through that. And where we could see problems with there, you know, with one year group, we felt that there was maybe some of the students were really, really missing that piece where they were not meeting each other and they weren't getting an opportunity to just hang out together. So we set them a task of, from now to next week's assembly, we want you to just connect to somebody in your class that you normally would be chatting to every day of the week that you simply haven't spoken to since the 12th of March. And we don't need to know about it, but it's just making that a priority for them as well, because they really are missing that part, that peer interaction that is so, so important at that age. And those wee things have helped a little bit anyway, they're telling us. So
yeah, definitely. I just have a comment here, and I suppose just maybe to acknowledge the role of senior management at the moment. It just says it's very important for senior management to mind themselves. We are connecting with so many people. It's hard sometimes because we don't always get too much feedback. So I guess the focus today has been really around students, around parents, and around maybe colleagues and teaching staff, but also maybe as a senior management group as well. Maybe, like you say, supporting one another. I think Fiona, you maybe touched on that by giving yourself permission to acknowledge and find the situation challenging, and being able to maybe reach out to your colleagues and your staff members for support when you need it.
Yeah, and even on the senior management thing, like I think it's really important that leaders connect in with each other as well. I know as a Donegal ETV school, we're really, really lucky because, you know, we have 15 post-primary schools within Donegal ETV, and we as principals have met on a hangout, you know, a number of times. And we're great, you know, we're getting great leadership, you know, from our chief executive and director of schools. But the fact that us as principals can come together as well, it's invaluable, even just for someone else to say, that's exactly the thing that's keeping me awake as well, you know. And then you're like, right, we're okay, we're all managing, it's fine, you know.
Yeah, definitely. I think I'm part of a new principals group on WhatsApp, and I think I probably wouldn't have been as in contact with them as much if this hadn't have happened almost, you know, especially within the first year and all that, you're kind of motoring along. But I think there's been unbelievable support to each other on it. And that kind of go like try and bring that back to our school as well. We've got four people within our senior management team, and we've been very good to each other. We've been really, really good to each other. Having the normal conversation as opposed to constantly always about school and making sure we're all asking how's so and so and how's the dog and how's your family and all that we're having the normal conversation. We're not forgetting that, or we're not just kind of checking, oh, did you get that sent or did you do that? So making sure that we're still being human at the back of it all. And again, I think it's so important, as you said there, Fiona, sharing with people that definitely that there's days and you're struggling, and you know, I'm a stay-at-home mother at the moment, and I'm a full-time principal, as with many people. So everybody's in the same boat, and everybody has their own difficulties at home, and being able to share that and show that human side here to people as well, say that, yeah, it's okay to struggle, it's fine to struggle, and I completely understand it, and definitely get it off your chest. I'll happily listen and have a chat on the phone and and give out about a few things, and it's good. It's good for the soul.
Yeah, it's so important to have kind of colleagues who I suppose understand exactly what it is that you are going through and just to be able to. I have another question in here. 6 years are possibly struggling the most as they are at an important juncture in their lives and with the uncertainty around the leave insert adding to their stress levels. How are your schools supporting 6 years in particular?
I think the 6 years across the whole country are under serious pressure at the moment with the lack of clarity that's going on. So we've been very clear with them to kind of say, just focus on the only fact that you have at the moment is the 29th of July, that nothing else has been decided upon or told to schools or anything like that. That people are, as when we said earlier about there's somebody else making that decision, so try not to be focusing on all the different ways that this is going to pan out. But the only fact you have at the moment is the 29th of July, and that's what they're focusing on. And just to go easy on yourself, and if you need to get up and go for a walk or go out to the garden or do your study tomorrow, it's fine, you know, not to heap too much pressure on yourself and to talk to people and keep chatting to people. I think a lot of them are kind of almost, they're just much more isolated at the moment, and maybe they're afraid to ask the question and they're afraid to put up a question on the group chat because it's so different to putting your hand up in class. And I'm kind of a bit afraid to do that. So trying to get the information out there to them, but only the facts and sticking to the facts. I know we're organising a graduation for an online graduation. So we're doing a video, kind of a drone video of the school with some candles out in the grass for them. And so little things like that, but for them to know that that is happening. They were very concerned over the grad not happening. And we were kind of saying, well, it's not possible, it's not safe to do it. So that's kind of where their mind was. They were like, oh, we still have this kind of, they're holding on to something, that they were going to have some kind of a ceremony and we're going, well, it won't be in person, but we will organize something. And to just even let them in on that, yeah, we're planning this and we're doing that and we're going to have a candle for every one of you, and it'll be something really special, and we'll all record video messages for you. And to even just let them in know or get them involved in that, what would they like, and you know, would do they want to have input into it, and what kind of, you know, who do they want to hear from and all that. And so giving them a little bit of ownership over it as well, but saying, yeah, we're going ahead with something. It won't be the normal thing, but we're going ahead with something for it. So to give them something to look forward to anyway, you know?
Yeah, and that, I think those kind of things are key for the 6 years at the minute. You know, we would usually be planning for your, you know, your graduation, your end of year service, and it's usually, you know, they have such an input into it. So we're doing an online yearbook thing. So we have sent out a document to them. It's like a PowerPoint, and they each have one or two slides that they have responsibility for, where they we want them to showcase their experiences in Mulroy College over the last 5 or 6 years, so that we create this virtual yearbook for them, and we'll be asking staff to collate letters as well. So the staff will be writing them all individual letters, and we'll pull that together as well, and things like that, to just acknowledge, you know, the full journey of school, that they are coming to an end. It's not just, you know, not just to focus on the period from the 12th of March until now, or necessarily the leave insert, but to actually celebrate what the whole journey that they have been through, like we normally would be doing. And I suppose there's quite a level of support being given to them through the guidance counsellor as well, and making them aware of all of the different information sessions and webinars and things that are happening for all of the colleges and universities now, so they can still access all of that. And just, I suppose, highlighting to them as well, like Lucia said, you know, we can only focus on the plan that we have, and it's unbelievably tough for them to be surrounded by so much speculation at the minute. I've been quite honest with them by telling them that I receive information the same way that they do. I hear it on the news. I don't get anything directly from the Department of Education. It's usually a press release, and that's how we receive the information too. And that's difficult to manage then, because there's usually opinions that come behind that before we can step in and just talk to them about that. So that's become more difficult. But the fact that they hear how it happens has helped that. And also we're trying to highlight to them the positives in this, that our leaving certs at the minute are they're developing a set of skills that are going to stick with them for the rest of their lives. They are going to be going into colleges and universities better equipped than they ever would have been, self-directed learning, meeting deadlines, all of these things. They don't have to figure half of that out next year, and you know, they will be sitting at a point next year and they'll be thinking, I got through that and I have incredible resilience. And you know, they're going to be a very, very employable cohort in a number of years' time when they get through everything. So trying to highlight things like that to them as well, focus on the now, focus on the positives, and we're here, and we will, schools will remain supporting them through June, July, August, whatever is needed, and just to know that we'll be here for them.
I think it's so nice to hear when someone asks a question about how you're supporting 6 years, that the conversation didn't focus on the leaving certificate, that it focused on acknowledging that support for 6 years is acknowledging the school journey, like you said. It's something significant of 6 years. It's your final days of secondary school education and a massive transition into a whole new life stage. And that has been disrupted in a sense at the moment, and those normal celebrations or acknowledgements in terms of grads and things like that, that's all disrupted. So for 6 year students, it's not support purely to focus on the exams necessarily, but everything that comes with maybe what the experience of being in 6 year at this time might encompass. And maybe like you say, if you want to focusing maybe on some of the positive aspects of that, and maybe fostering I suppose the opportunities for students to recognize that actually the skills I'm developing right now, it's not to invalidate the stress that I'm experiencing right now, but the skills I'm developing right now are going to stand to me in a huge way for the next chapter of my life. And really being able to reinforce that, I think it's been just quite refreshing to kind of have a conversation of kind of acknowledging that piece as well, and probably will go a long way in bringing that bit of positivity into maybe the conversation for LEAMSR students, who has the entire country talking about them at the moment and not really in a very positive way, I suppose. And I think it's nice to maybe create those conversations that maybe just change it a little bit and look at maybe some alternative perspectives on the situation. That's been great. I don't know, Erica, have you any final questions? I'm just conscious of the time that we're going slightly over.
Yeah, slightly over. I might just a really quick one, if you have a brief answer, just come in a good few minutes ago. What type of end of term assessments would you recommend in current times? Question based, creative pieces, or project based? So just if you had kind of any idea on that.
I suppose, it's very individual to your school, I think. There needs to be consultation within the school of what best supports you guys. That we did a good 2 or 3 weeks of planning. We had one plan, didn't work. We had another plan, we had to adapt that. And it did evolve. It took a little while for that to evolve and for discussion and debate to open up about it. So we're doing 70% for junior certs, we're doing 70% previous results and 30% assignment. Then for the rest of the year groups, we're doing something kind of similar like that, but it's very much down to the subject departments in the group. So we have a very large school, so it's I know some schools are doing online testing and all that. Wouldn't really have worked for ours. But so it's quite an individual thing, which means a lot of discussion and collaboration within your own school would have to happen in order to get the most kind of the sustainable or the most suitable solution for you. But that's kind of how we're doing with it. But it was a lot of discussion, and we did finally come up with a plan, and a lot of it is down to the subject departments and the collaboration within the subject departments to see what they're doing.
And similar, I suppose, we the online exam thing just didn't really work for us. But we have, you know, it's project work, it's case studies, it's things like that that are being assessed at the minute, as well as taking into consideration all of the work that was done throughout the course of the year, because end of year assessment is an assessment and a review of the entire year. So it's a mixture of all of those things, very similar to what Lucia said.
I think an important thing to note on that, is time management for students, that it's over a kind of a 2 week period of assessments. So we did send out, or we are today sending out a podcast on time management and how to plan when you get your deadlines, how to plan all that out over the next 2 weeks so that they're not going, oh my God, I'm after getting 9 assignments and they have to be done by whatever. So it's time management for the student as well, and how to actually plan that out with the student and the parent over the next week or two. Okay.
Thanks so much. I think we had some really valuable information there. Just on a final note, or did you have another one, Michelle?
No, I just wanted just when you mentioned podcasts, see, I'm just referring to an earlier question that came in to ask you what platform you're using for your podcasts. Do you have a specific platform?
No, we don't know. She's uploading it onto YouTube, and then we're putting it up onto NS Teams, then Microsoft Teams. So no, there's no specific platform to make it as accessible as possible. No, she makes a recording of herself and uploads it onto our YouTube channel, and then it goes on to Microsoft Teams then. So that was the easiest way to do it. Otherwise, you had to sign up to other different things. And I also needed to be able to share it through text message on VSware. So it was the easiest thing was the link for YouTube. So that was the safest, easiest way to do it.
Great. Sorry, Erica, that was just the last one. I nearly forgot.
No problem. And I might just mention another comment come in, just letting teachers know that NEPS released a document yesterday for 6 months that a teacher found helpful.
Yeah, that's very good.
Okay, very good. I suppose, I'm conscious of time. Just lastly, if you had one key message to share with our participants today on the theme of connectedness, is there anything that comes to mind?
Well, for us anyway, the kind of main theme that I'm sharing with our community is sustainability. That even over the summer and all that, it's going to be quite a different summer than we would normally expect. And students and teachers and parents mightn't have the rest time that they normally would in order to kind of gear yourself up for next year. So keeping things sustainable and on a very steady, simple flow, and trying to keep that so that we're not up and down and peaking and rushing to things and then slowing down again, and that's not sustainable. So trying to make sure that we're looking after ourselves so that we can look after everybody else as well, and that we're kind of communicating properly with students. But yeah, sustainability is kind of what I'm saying to our school community anyway, is to look after yourself so that we're not kind of going to peak and then drop. So it's really important to keep that very steady and very simple, keep things really simple.
Okay. Yeah, and I suppose it's very similar, because I talk a lot within the staff and students about expectations and being very mindful of our expectations now of each other as well as everyone else. But I suppose just to make that effort to reach out, that when there is a struggle, a question, a bad day, whatever it may be, an assessment that you can't do, a teacher that's just overwhelmed, can't manage, whatever it is, just reach out to somebody, to a colleague, to a peer, to someone. And school communities are so open in their ability to support people, even in this capacity that we're in right now. And also just, I think, for teachers to be reminded, and for all of us to be reminded ourselves, of the impact that we are still having on young people. We are having hugely positive impacts on young people at a time when they are surrounded by a world that is very unsure at the minute. So it's probably more important that we're aware of how positively we can be there for them.
Okay. Positive note to end on. That I suppose, and in Jigsaw we are so aware of the huge impact that teachers have on the lives of young people. So I suppose that, and that's why we find these webinars so helpful, because the I suppose the influence that you're having and the positive influence you're having is so important. I'm not sure if you have anything else to add, Michelle.
No, I'm just getting lots of comments of thank yous and appreciations to the two school principals who have taken their time to come here today and to join us for this webinar. I think the insights and the experience and the compassion that you've shown has really added so much value to this webinar. So can I just thank Lucia and Fiona again for coming? And it's certainly been acknowledged by the participants that have joined us here today as well. So and thanks to everybody else for joining us, I guess, just to add that piece.
Thanks very much.
Yeah. Okay, take care.
Thank you so much. Bye bye.
Thank you.
Bye bye. Bye bye.